Urien, losing 3,100 has some people thinking to themselves, how much did we really pile on to fundamentals because we thought phase one was going to get signed?
Yeah, I mean, certainly the roller coaster of tariffs and trade, you know, phase one deals or not phase one deals continues. The market did have a nice breakout out of a 21-month-long holding pattern. And at this point, you know, the top of that holding pattern is around 3,000 and change, and we're pretty close to that. So my guess is that we'll retest that ceiling, and that would be, you know, a 4 to 6% decline in the S&P. You know, with a market that over the last 10 years has gone up 17% per year, and even since the valuation peak in 2018 has gone up 12%, we need to take that sort of, you know, in stride and accept that, you know, ups and downs are going to happen. But in terms of the ISM, as you point out, you know, it was a little bit weaker this week. But generally speaking, once the ISM has peaked and you're about a year to a year and a half later, generally speaking, the forward returns and the batting average start to really pick up as the market starts to kind of discount a recovery. And I think that's generally remains the theme for the market. So I remain constructive over the next, you know, 6 to 12 months or so.
Okay. Manish, how about you, especially given that folks looking for global stabilization, particularly in Europe, did sort of pin that to at least the lack of an escalation in trade rhetoric, right?
Absolutely. So I think, you know, one of the reasons definitely that we had this little bit of a rally over the last few weeks was because of the hopes of that some resolution of the trade war. However, actually, I would point out that if you look under the hood, leaving aside the overall S&P index, if you look at the actual stocks that are more directly impacted by the trade war, investors appear to be taking more of a wait-and-see approach. So our China trade basket, which sort of focuses on, you know, 60 or 70 names which you think are directly impacted by trade war, that has not gone back to the, let's say, the April highs that we saw earlier in the year. So I think investors were taking a wait-and-see approach, and that, I guess, in some sense has been borne out by the recent developments.
So, Manish, just to dig into that a little bit further then, on a day like today, it's risk off. You see Treasury yields falling. You see gold up. You see utilities and real estate, the best performers, are really the only performers that are green within the S&P right now. Are you saying that those are the types of places that investors should continue to park their money?
I think we're taking, so in terms of our sector allocations, we're taking a mixed approach. So as you said, the risk of recession over the last few weeks has actually gone down. So cyclicals have outperformed. However, we think it's too early to sort of completely switch to cyclicals. So we think the recession risk have come down, but we're not completely out of the woods. And so we're taking a balanced approach. So in terms of our overweight, you know, one of the things, we are long industrials, but we're also long healthcare. So I think it's good to take sort of a barbell approach and not completely swing for the cyclicals right now.
Urien, president a moment ago, said he pays more attention to the job market than the stock market. And we are going to get a look at jobs later in the week. We know the run rate's down by a quarter from a year ago. What's your outlook on that? And I wonder, into 2020 as well.
It does come all down to jobs, right? So we've been in a global trade recession, if you will, for over a year and a half. The PMIs all over the world, you know, did fall below 50. Some of them are starting to bounce. Certainly, our ISM did not, as was expected, as you mentioned earlier. But ultimately, the transmission mechanism from a trade or a manufacturing recession to an actual jobs recession would be when profit margins continue to erode because you have late cycle, you know, pressures on wages, et cetera, and that that slowdown in profits juxtaposed by rising wages ends up forcing companies to lay off people. And that's how you actually get a general recession. So everyone, of course, is looking at the jobless claims. Those will come out on Thursday, as they do every week. And those numbers have been very, very strong. But that is sort of the latest indicator that I think everyone will be watching. And as soon as it starts to tick up, everyone will start to proclaim the recession. I don't really expect it. I think the consumer side does remain strong, and I think the Fed's three rate cuts along with a pretty rapid expansion of its balance sheet, I think give the market a justifiable sense that, that we are past the weakest part of the economic cycle. And, you know, markets discount, right? This is why we see the PE go up to 18 times earnings, even though earnings are slowing, because this is how markets work. And I think this is what the markets are pricing in for next year. It may not be a robust recovery, but I do expect some recovery, and that the jobs picture, even though it will slow in terms of growth, will remain intact.